شما کلوفون میگی به جانی و دیل ریحانه آم شد هست مخیل و احمد خورزه این سیتن بودراند آتورایت امریکا The Assyrian Aid Society of America شد هفوت آتورد سان هوزه Assyrian American Association of San Jose آم شد هست آتورایت امریکا The Assyrian Foundation of America قبولو خونی و خوشنه ودیوم یوم خملالا خاسیا و خمپیرا جونتن اسیا نیکلس از جیلو ایلا امان مقرب خممل سیقارت کلن ود افلت نیونتن جو گلوت انی بخاین جو اطرد ابعاتن بساس کلوخون بد مقربان خکمان و قارب ود یلپاند اسیا نیکلس از جیلو بلیشاند انگلش Dr. Nicholas JELOO is an Australian-born Assyrian who holds a PhD in Syriac Studies from the University of Sydney, a Master's in Eastern Christianity, and a Bachelor's in Semitic Languages. He is currently a contributing member of international scholarly and professional associations such as the Middle East Studies Association of North America, the Association for the Study of the Middle East and Africa, the Golden Key International Honor Society. Dr. JELOO is a former recipient of many scholarships, such as Assyrian Foundation of America Scholarship, University of Sydney International Exchange Scholarship, as well as several universities of Sydney postgraduate research support schemes. He has conducted several field trips among Assyrian communities in Iraq, Syria, Iran, and Turkey, as well as Iraqi refugee communities in Jordan and Lebanon. Additionally, in 2009 and 2010, he was commissioned by the Assyria Council of Europe and Hammurabi Human Rights Organization in Iraq to conduct primary research on the ground in specific cases of human rights abuses. The result was a three-part report totaling 132 pages titled The Struggle to Exist, which was presented to the European Parliament in Brussels. Along with his continuous academic accomplishments, Dr. Nicholas is also an artist and amateur photographer in his exhibition about Assyrian life in the Middle East called Persistence and Existence. Was displayed at the mainstream art galleries and public libraries in both Sydney and Melbourne between 2010 and 2012. Today, Dr. Nicholas JELOO has joined us to present this finding about the current situation of Assyrians in the diaspora and the homeland. مقام شرف لخورزن من اسيا نيكولس بايب طلبك من اسيا روبرت كاروكيان خامن هدامن Assyrian Foundation of America حقد البيمة ومقرب قاتن كما خبر بلخانة Assyrian Foundation وداخل كسندة قيالو بد أمتن تاممي دارغة الله يد مدرشتا ان بس مالوخون اسيا روبرت
Assyriology, meaning even in London. I can pick the Assyriologist, even in Sweden, who called a PhD scholar of Assyriology to Helsinki. I'm a Praiva Kordaya, also in Syria. But put on without the code, I'm a woman, look at the Tanyahine Kordaya, get the Praiva Assyriology to universities to Europe. همین را به خیلی که می دیدش که ویا همین همین خرچ پردازی و آربایی و ترکیه که به پراین علی اسیریولوژی و خنده تان خا می دیانه به پراین پناه ای و روا سنای سابق أني كل بقراي وكل خرجة قريتا خرجت قرأتها خرجت خيوتها خرجت خشتا conferences كل فشتا قريتا بيات سندانه وأخنا المغنقلس برسو بوي طاريا من دي المجد إن ألفا تريبا ما خطفا ما في خديو دي لخم So, then why you answer that success of your mother, Urmi, Mother, Tatre, Blasha Bate, and in Chuda, Blay, Hesta, Tete, Piesta, Chuda Kajina, Laki Haji Madras, or Haji Tretu, Martin Kubrigana, Adia Mioka Kurkov, Italy PhD, Adia Lazan Shulari. I'm a Siva, Ariva Matava Minan, Ariva Medicine, Ariva Engineering, Ariva Law, Business, أبي أقول قلق وخيبات علينا. إن البيخ اللي خيب مجد، أنا مصاش بجد زودا، قريل وكل قضاء سبيشل في هذه الأيام، وضام الله قد أبي الشوة. وكما تشكت الشوة، يخاف في سبيسيفيك فيو، إت أسيريان ستاديز، للا سنة. إن أبي قريل كردش ستاديز، كان فلسطينيان ستاديز، كان إيرانيان ستاديز، كان عربيك ستاديز، ما سيوا إيش بايو أزوزن. قانیل و مخوری و مدرسه الله یه مراقبه سنایوتا. این آدیا دادار هدیت لب دایی پانی دیت لب میجد. حالا لند بیک از سر جد شو ما. سو اخن اطراف کدام دیت و چی چی بخواد واندیم دام ولاد. اخمن نگمجا با یک سند خروس جلاین کد باي فاي دل دی فیلز. و مجا اما بر خالصه و بر کرکم کرتا. عیل شو ما. Shatast operated America, the Syrian Foundation of Tani Muhammad Damo, Itla Scholarship Program, Kadela Kam Yakmarin, Akmirin Kamikol Sukhinus Kilak, Irak Chiha Hayorta, Ha Tanakh, Ha Magzet Hayorta, Ha Yon Snadeva, in a Leila Korea, Kai Kulis Nikoyate. Damo of Technan Shabba Fayuraka Shutase, the Itla programs. لاختی های روکس جولایان این تخمین ها بازد شتست چیرز اسیریان ستادیز پروگرامز یو یونیورسیتیز لخا و یو یورپ آسترالیا گد انیوز جولایان رو با پاروگینا مدرسه بایده و دارغه ایلان تاویان شو اقا تجسپارا گد نگیمت پاروردای چاپ اکتار پاشید دی و مقریب قاتی یا گامن مقریب و کفیل و اکتار و مقریب و درس قدیان و فکر ناشکنی. پتو سالی سخصیات نکلس ایده لنگوش آخین مقدیلی با ازی سخصیل و کتفیل و مغزیل و قدیان و ناشکنی جدوی. سو میجید نکلس ویرس نکدیان احنا نیوکس نیکل نکلس سبب لگن لب نکلس انی نیان بیده با هم مبات کت سخصیل رابر نیوکا دفریل تلیخ و پرپس و شویقنا این نکلس امیلاوی بویدو بود خشم شد هیچ من نل پاشوا و خیام کدام مرات ماسیب سری و کدیش دامن خلیبی ها پرواز. این ابو خاطر شو نکلا سپیدو داد یک نام ماسا باز بود. یاد نیم تفاوت خدمت می احنا میان دوچه میان بتفاوت میان برام میان مدرسه کد پرواز و شر شو شر. So نتی آن لخ تان پایروک اسیریان فاندیشن ایشایی این باین تان پایروک کلا میدارم حالا شاید سبب خاکیس و امتنایا، اما مربوط تنایا، که تخمینا مجر سندف و های را قدر مشکلایا، که انز های دی قدیا مخام حرم مزید.
جواب باسیما، دکتر رابرت، ادیا طلبه من اسیا، نیکلس، حضرت و مغرب لغا خمزمتون.
بایم تانن هایتون رابا بسیم قهدر توخن لخا قطع توخن قدی رابی و انت تلب بیلا قد خزن هدخا کنشا گورا من بنا امتن تیه لخا طینان بمنتون هلبت من شو تپوتت آتور من سیتت ادرانا من شتست آتوریتا او من کل عانیت قد شرکینا قا مریستت اها لیلی اها رمشا و بينتانن زبشارتا قد اهم زمت مريزون بلشانت انجلس لكربيتن مني مريزون بلشانت انجلس سو ان اتلوخن بقاره مني ماسيتون بقريتون من برهادخ وانا رابط خادن جوبن بقاروخن An ancient Greek saying, often attributed to Socrates, says, Know thyself, diganuch. Knowledge is power, and to know who you are is to empower yourself. This will be a recurring theme throughout this talk. In the last century or more, Assyrians have endured an extraordinary amount of violence, population movement, and destruction of cultural heritage. It has been estimated that this has occurred at least once every 20 or so odd years in recent history. Since the 19th century, however, these events have grown more and more devastating as the nationalistic ambitions of our Kurdish, Arab, and Turkish neighbors have gradually risen, and since we've become embroiled in conflicts between parties that do not concern us and over which we have no control. Such man-made disasters include the following ones which I've listed here, starting in the 1820s and continuing all the way until today, what we see happening in Iraq and in Syria. Now, this lecture will examine a few things. It will examine the current situation of the Assyrians both in the Middle East and in the diaspora, as well as the struggle to maintain and preserve their ancient language and culture. It will also explore the possible fate of the Assyrian people and discuss the urgent need for language and cultural preservation, as well as maintaining indigenous Assyrian communities in the Middle East. So firstly, a few definitions. What is a homeland? A homeland, or native land, is the concept of the place to which an ethnic group holds a long history and a deep cultural association with. The country in which a particular national identity began. The areas which constitute the Assyrian homeland are the adjoining parts of northern Iraq, southeastern Turkey, northwest Iran, and northeast Syria. Prior to the Assyrian genocide, many districts within these areas were inhabited predominantly by Assyrian majorities in compact groups of villages and towns. Among these were the Hakkari Highlands and the Tur Abdin Plateau of Turkey, the plains of Urmi and Salamis in Iran, the Nineveh Plains in Iraq, etc. Today, all but Hakkari have retained minuscule native Assyrian populations. So here is just a map, thanks to aina.org, which illustrates to you, so I can point with this, but it's no problem. It illustrates to you the basic area which constitutes Assyria. Here you have Khabur, the Nineveh Plains, Hakkari, Van, Tur Abdin, Urmi. A lot of people think that when we say Atra, when we say the homeland, we only mean Iraq. No, Urmi is Atra, Hakkari is Atra, Tur Abdin is Atra, Khabur is Atra. So here is a brief list showing you where the Assyrians live in the Middle East at the moment. Well, in the four countries which make up Atra for us. It has those areas which I mentioned, for example, Khabur or North Iraq or Urmi Salamis, as opposed to the rest of the country, so you can see the differences. If you want these statistics after the lecture, I can happily give them to anyone. Now, of the more than 3 million Christian Assyrians in the world today, from all the various churches, so of all the 3 million Assyrians in the world today, from all the different churches, little more than 1.25 million, maybe 45%, remain in the Middle East. So more than 50% of our people are actually living outside of the homeland, outside of the Middle East. Of these, the ones that have remained, roughly 300,000, or 24%, are refugees. 16% are internally displaced, so refugees in their own native country. with more than 44% living in war-torn areas, so living in war zones. This only leaves about 16% of the Assyrians in the Middle East who are living in relative peace and stability in places like northern Iraq, Iran, Turkey, and other places. Obviously, this does not bode well for the future sustainability and continued presence of Assyrian communities in the Middle East in general. Now, in Iraq, the Assyrians and Chaldeans are recognized in the country's constitution, and Christians have the right to 5 seats in the national parliament and a ministry in the cabinet. This is not ideal, and the constitution includes many articles which contradict each other regarding us, such as making Islam the official religion of all legislation and lawmaking. Compared with the previous regime, however, this is an improvement. In the Iraqi Kurdistan Autonomous Region in the north, Christians have been reserved 5 seats and a ministry, whilst the Syrians since 1991 in the north and since 2003 in the rest of the country have been able to open up numerous schools, cultural centers, and civil society organizations, including a Syriac Studies Department at Baghdad University and the Syriac Museum in Erbil. These face numerous challenges from majority groups such as the Kurds. It should be noted that up to 200,000 Assyrians in Iraq are actually internally displaced. And efforts to create an Assyrian autonomous unit in the Nineveh Plains, where a large concentration of indigenous communities live, have yet to come into fruition. In Iran, I know many people here probably come from Iran. The Assyrians have been recognized as an indigenous ethno-religious minority since the country's 1908 constitutional reform, and since then, they have had the right to representation in the country's majlis, or parliament. This is current even today, and the Assyrians also have the right to own and run their private schools, with 2 in the capital, Tehran, and 2 in Urmi. There are also 10 Assyrian associations in cities throughout the country linked to the central one in Tehran. The Iranian government has also paid a lot of money to restore historic Assyrian churches, which have also been placed on Iran's national heritage list. And it even funds the yearly Tammuz games in Urmi, which attract Assyrian sporting teams not only from all over Iran, but also from Iraq, Armenia, Georgia, Russia, and before the current problems, also from Syria. There are, however, instances where Assyrians may face discrimination because of their religion, since they live under an Islamic system of government. In Syria, Assyrians are recognized according to their sectarian divisions and not as a unified ethnic group. So if you belong to the Chaldean Catholic Church, they know you as a Kaldani. If you belong to the Syrian Orthodox or Syrian Catholic Churches, you're a Syriani. And if you belong to the Assyrian Church of the East or the Ancient Church of the East, you're an Ashuri. That's it. It's interesting, I should also note that the word Syria, if many of you might not know, the word Syria actually derives from the word Assyria. And so it was actually once part of the original Assyrian homeland. When people say, but Nahran only for Iraq, I sort of get a little bit angry because you see this here, this is the Euphrates, and this here is the Tigris. So all of this land in Syria is actually Bat Nahran. Now there are 2 Assyrian members in Syria's parliament, at least last time I checked, since before the war, and 1 minister in the country's cabinet. The Syrian Orthodox Church runs about 8 private schools in major cities and towns, and the Church of the East has 1 school in Qamishli. The Syrian Catholics also have some schools. Education in rural areas is usually conducted by local teachers during the summer holidays. And currently, the Jazeera area, which I just pointed out, Syrian Mesopotamia, is controlled by Islamist jihadist rebels and Kurdish factions, with government control only in some small pockets in the major towns. Many Assyrians have been kidnapped or killed in the current chaos, and thousands have escaped to Turkey and Lebanon, emptying out a number of villages. Turkey. In Turkey, Assyrians are not recognized as a minority, and they thus have no right to own and run their own private schools in the country. So even though we still have about maybe 20 to 30,000 Assyrians living in Turkey, most of them Syrian Orthodox or Chaldean, they're not recognized. They have no legal status as a minority. The Syrian Orthodox Church, however, does manage to utilize its monasteries in the southeast of the country to teach local children the language on weekends. There is currently one Assyrian member of parliament in Turkey who was recently elected through the efforts of a pro-Kurdish political party. Now, apart from these four countries, we also have Assyrians in Israel, Palestine, in Lebanon, and we do also have Assyrian private schools in Beirut and in Bethlehem, of all places. Now, the major problem for Assyrians in the Middle East is immigration. Without proper recognition by their governments, without the rule of law, without the ability to appropriately defend themselves and their villages from attack from outside, hundreds of thousands of Assyrians have voted with their feet and now await visas for Australia, New Zealand, America, Canada, and Europe. The conditions that await them in the diaspora are no better, since they are faced with dispersion, language loss, estrangement from their homelands and cultures and families, and imminent assimilation. So, another definition. What is a diaspora? A diaspora, from the Greek word meaning dispersion, is a scattered population with a common origin in a smaller geographic area, involuntarily dispersed outside of its original homeland. So, not out of its own will. It's not out of its own will that they've left. It's involuntarily. It is a transnational community that defines itself as a singular ethnic group based upon its shared identity. Ethnic diaspora communities are now recognized by scholars as an inevitable and endemic feature of the current international system. Now, recently, scholarship has distinguished between different kinds of diaspora, based on the causes, such as imperialism, trade, labor, chain migration, etc. Some diaspora communities maintain strong political ties with their homeland. Other qualities that may be typical of many diasporas are thoughts of return, relationships with other communities in the diaspora, and a lack of full assimilation into the host countries. The oldest surviving Assyrian diaspora community was established by a merchant named Thomas of Cana. That's his photo up there. Well, what they think he looks like. Who, in the year 345 AD, about 1,600 years ago, he migrated to southern India to help replenish the local Christian community. With him, he took about 400 people from Mesopotamia, belonging to 72 families from 7 clans, a bishop named Moriosip, 4 priests and many deacons. Their descendants, known as the Knanaya community, now number more than 300,000, belonging largely to the Syro-Malabar Catholic Church and the Syriac Orthodox Church. Originally, they used to belong to the Church of the East, but after the 1500s, when the Portuguese came and forced the locals to convert to Catholicism, things sort of changed. Whilst these people no longer speak Assyrian, they have kept traditions which distinguish them from other South Indian Christians. And also, they're endogamous, which means they do not intermarry with other communities. They only marry from within their own community. Another early Assyrian diaspora from modern times was formed by the forced removal of an estimated 100,000 Assyrians from the Urmia region in Iran, which you can see here, to Shahriar in Khorasan by Nader Shah. This was between 1732 and 1736. Now, when this happened, many Assyrians died along the way. However, and those who survived eventually either returned to Urmi or they stayed. They stayed, but they converted to Islam and assimilated into the local population.
Being farmers or rural agriculturalists with no specific wealth or skills, with no education, with no leaders, with no national awareness, they were unable to maintain themselves in Khorasan as a specific community. 100 years before them, on the other hand, Shah Abbas of Persia imported hundreds of thousands of Armenians and Georgians from the Caucasus, so from up here, to the center of Iran around Isfahan. The Armenians being skillful artisans and wealthy merchants, and the Georgians being hardened warriors, both communities have been able to maintain their cultures and languages so far removed from their original homelands until today, despite the fact that all the Georgians even converted from Christianity to Islam. So if you go to Isfahan, you'll find Georgians, Gorjaye, who speak Georgian, who make wine and drink wine, but they're Muslim. The next oldest surviving Assyrian diasporas, on the other hand, are in the Middle East, and these are represented by the communities in Israel, Palestine, and Lebanon. These began in the 1700s and have been replenished by new waves of migrants until today. Next are the communities in the former Soviet Union, and especially Georgia. Several dozen Assyrian families from the Ottoman and Persian empires settled there after 1770, and these were joined by larger numbers after the Treaty of Turkmenchay in 1828, which ended the wars between Russia and Iran. These new settlers not only settled in Georgia and established villages there, but they also established settlements in Armenia, Azerbaijan, and Russia. After this, further communities were established in Egypt under the rule of Muhammad Ali Pasha in the early half of the 1800s. In the USA around 1882, and here is a photograph of one of the earliest Assyrian-American associations, which was established in 1917 in Chicago. So Assyrians have been in this country for a long time. Also Canada, and also many South American countries. The next oldest diaspora communities were established between 1919 and 1924 after the First World War by genocide survivors, and these include France, the UK, Jordan, and Greece. Unlike their Armenian and Jewish neighbors, the Assyrians were slow to establish communities in Europe and the New World. This is most likely due to the fact that they were not as numerous, not as urbanized, were not as renowned as artisans or craftsmen, and were not as savvy in mercantile enterprises. Prior to the First World War, most Assyrians outside of Urmi and a few cities in northern Mesopotamia were illiterate farmers. In many of the cities especially, most of the Assyrians spoke Arabic, Turkish, Armenian, and felt no connection with the Aramaic-speaking Assyrians in the surrounding villages. For example, the native... For example, the native Assyrians of Mosul, who are Arabic-speaking, and have historically looked down upon the Assyrians of the Nineveh Plains villages, call them فَلِّحِي مِنْ أَهَلْ بَغَى, or, you know, country bumpkins, you know, people from outside. Similarly, the Arabic-speaking Assyrians of Mardin and its surrounding villages look down upon those of Tur Abdin, calling them Tawarne, or mountaineers, Nashatura. This situation was lamented by Chaldean Catholic Bishop Mar ad-Deshir in the introduction to his History of Chaldea and Assyria, Tarikh Kaldu Athur, which he wrote in 1912. This lack of homogeneity and internal national unity was further exacerbated by sectarian divisions and disputes between and within the individual Assyrian churches. Thus, with Assyrians separated into various smaller groups, they would not be able to pool their efforts and resources together in order to create successful diaspora institutions that would preserve their language and culture. Professor Ashur Yusuf, who was actually originally a member of the Syrian Orthodox Church, he was Yaqubaya. He was the editor of the Assyrian monthly magazine, Murshid Athuriyun, the Assyrian Guide, published in the Turkish city of Kharput between 1909 and 1915. He spoke candidly about this and also about identity fragmentation. In his article, Reasons for the Backwardness of the Assyrians, published on the 20th of October 1914, he wrote the following. The hindrance to the development of the Assyrians was not so much the attacks from without as it was from within. The doctrinal and sectarian disputes and struggles is a good example. These caused divisions, spiritually and nationally, among the people who quarreled among themselves even to the point of shedding blood, thus creating a permanent schism. To this very day, the Assyrians are still known by various names, such as Nestorians, Jacobites, Chaldeans, etc. These dissensions sapped the physical and moral energy of the people and destroyed the sources of enlightenment, namely, promising educational institutions. I mean, back then there were only maybe three or four divisions. Today we have many more. It's sad. In the 20th century, and especially since the Semele massacre in 1933, many Assyrian churches have formed and developed their own identities based on church affiliation. So, through this, we've seen the development of the Chaldean and Aramean nations. This has also led to a crystallization and affiliation of the Assyrian identity solely within the Church of the East. So now when people think of Church of the East, they think Assyrian. When they think of other churches, they think Chaldean or Syrian. They don't think that they're all Assyrian together, and that's unfortunate. Religion in general has been a major setback to Assyrian cohesion by further excluding all those who are not Christian. Now you might say to me, well, are there any Assyrians that aren't Christian? I'll say, well, yes, there are. It may or may not surprise you to know that there are more than 150,000 Aramaic-speaking Jews in Israel who originate from villages and towns in and around the Assyrian homeland. These communities are not new and can be dated to the conversion to Judaism of the Assyrian royal family of Erbil in the 1st century AD. Often, the dialects these Jews speak are mutually intelligible with what is being spoken by most Eastern Assyrians. For example, last week, I was in Los Angeles, and I met with Professor Yona Sabar, who is a Jew from Zaho. He left Zaho at age 13 in 1951, and his native language is Assyrian. I sat down speaking with him in Assyrian, having a conversation. We could completely understand one another. But he's Jewish and I'm Christian. Now, due to the exclusivity of the Assyrian identity, however, and its strong bond with Christianity, these Assyrian Jews identify as Kurdish, Kurdistani, or Aramaic Jews instead. There has been minimal to no attempt at outreach or relations between the Assyrians, so from the Assyrians towards these communities, on the part of the Assyrians. So just a quick photo. Down the bottom you can see a group of these Jews who speak Assyrian. This is a dance group of theirs in Israel. They're wearing Assyrian clothes. They're playing Dolo Zorna. They're dancing Assyrian dances. They speak Assyrian. They eat Assyrian food. Well, kosher versions of Assyrian food, but still. And in the photo up there, you see the tomb of the Queen of Erbil, which is in Jerusalem now. The tomb of the Queen of Erbil, Queen Helen, who converted from Ashurism or from paganism to Judaism. So she was an Assyrian that became a Jew. And that's the inscription from her tomb. For those that know how to read Astrangeli, it says Sadan Malikta, that was her name. Armenians, on the other hand, have been very active in maintaining relations with a group of Islamized Armenians in Turkey called the Hemshinli, who still speak Armenian even though they're Muslim. So, you know, nationalism can be any religion, even maybe no religion. At present, There are currently 1.5 million Assyrians living in the diaspora, scattered in between 45 and 50 countries throughout the world. Of these, you can see, roughly 700,000 in North America, 450,000 in Europe, 150,000 in Oceania, and 100,000 in Latin America. Now, there are large concentrations of Assyrians in many countries. If I go through them, I might run out of time. So, anyways, I was going to say that we see that in many of these countries, especially those where Assyrian populations are small and they've been there for a long time, the Assyrians have assimilated and no longer identify with their origins. In general, stateless ethnic diaspora communities have often found it difficult to maintain their language, identity, or culture past the third generation. Whilst it does certainly help when there is a nation state to help sponsor or direct educational and cultural programs towards their expatriate communities, this is, however, not vital. In Sydney, Assyrians have opened one primary and one high school, a childcare centre and a retirement village, thank you to the Assyrian Church of the East, and they also have a welfare centre and a library. There is also an Assyrian library and an Assyrian museum in Chicago. A high school was established by the Assyrians in Los Angeles and Phoenix, but those closed down because of lack of sustainability. The Syrian Orthodox Church now has plans to establish a private school in New Jersey, and in Sweden, in the town of Södertälje, the local community is also planning on building a private school. There are also Saturday or Sunday schools in many diaspora communities to teach the language, and Assyrian language courses are offered in many public schools in Europe, America, Australia. Now, I've even heard stories, I'm not sure if they're true, many people in the audience that have heard these could probably tell me if they know firsthand. I was told that in Turlock and Modesto, there are Assyrian courses taught in the high schools, but a lot of the Assyrian students, instead of learning Assyrian, go and learn Arabic or Persian or other languages because they're more popular. That's a problem. If that's true, it's a problem. Assyrian communities so far have been more active in establishing churches, halls, clubs, associations, and organizing themselves. They have been more active in both local and international political affairs, lobbying efforts, and sending aid to refugees and to Middle Eastern communities. Assyrians have not been as active in the educational front, unfortunately, and there are no privately funded Assyrian studies chairs at universities anywhere in the world. This is a disturbing pattern which does not bode well for the future of such communities. Out of 1.5 million Assyrians that live outside of the Middle East, in the last maybe 40 years, they've only been able to establish two or three schools, which is embarrassing. By far, the biggest threat to Assyrian diaspora communities is cultural assimilation. This is the process by which a person or a group's language and or culture come to resemble those of another group. The term can refer to either immigrant diasporas or native residents that come to be culturally dominated by another society. Hence, this is also applicable to Assyrian communities in the homeland. Assimilation may involve either a quick or gradual change depending on the circumstances. Full assimilation occurs when new members of a society become indistinguishable from members of another group. As noted, a major factor in this process is language shift, also referred to as language transfer, language replacement, or a language assimilation. This is the process whereby a community of speakers of one language becomes bilingual first in another language and gradually shifts to speaking that second language completely. Often, languages perceived to be higher status stabilize or spread at the expense of other languages perceived by their own speakers to be lower status. And we've already noted this in the case of the Assyrians of Mosul, the Assyrians of Mardin, who looked down upon the Assyrians from the villages as being low status. When a linguistic community ceases to speak their original language, this is what we call language death. Motat khalishana. Language shift can be detrimental to at least parts of the community associated with it. Sociolinguists report that language shift, when it involves loss of the first language, can lead to cultural disintegration and a variety of social problems, including increased alcoholism, dysfunctional families, and increased incidence of premature death. A tendency to bring up children as monolingual speakers of another language can lead to these children holding their heritage in disdain and feeling ashamed of the language of their parents and grandparents. As a result of this, some of them would feel neither fully part of their host country nor fully a member of their own ethnic group. So what's the solution? On the other hand, social integration is the movement of minority groups, such as ethnic minorities, refugees, and underprivileged sections of a society, to the mainstream. This requires proficiency in an accepted common language, acceptance of the laws of the society, and adoption of a common set of values belonging to that society. It does not require assimilation. So you don't need to assimilate to become fully American or to become fully Australian or to become fully a part of whatever countries you live in. And it does not require people to give up all of their culture, but it may require foregoing some aspects of their culture which are not consistent with the laws and values of that society. In tolerant and open societies, members of minority groups can often use social integration to gain full access to the opportunities, rights, and services available to the members of the mainstream society. Now, solutions for the homeland and diaspora. It is important that Assyrians maintain indigenous communities in the Middle East and do all they can to preserve their cultural heritage, whether it be in the form of buildings and artifacts, wherever possible. This would mean taking charge and being active in locating these, compiling lists and inventories of them and monitoring them, as well as restoring and maintaining churches, monasteries, cemeteries, and historic homes, and establishing museums and libraries to house Assyrian manuscripts, handcrafts, and other items. This is already being done by Armenians in Turkey and Jews in Europe and elsewhere. Our communities in the Middle East, and especially those within the limits of the traditional Assyrian heartland, represent an unbroken chain of Assyrian habitation, however large or small they are in number. So as long as we have people living in the homeland, they are proof that it is our homeland, because they are the descendants of those people that have historically lived there. Now, in the case of Turkey, we've witnessed many Assyrians return from Europe to their villages in Tur Abdin and Botan since 2001, building new homes and renewing their links to their historical lands. These photographs are from the village of Kafro Tahteito, or Lower Kafro, which is in Tur Abdin. After 2001, people from Europe started to return to their villages and to rebuild their houses. It's not only Kafro, there are also, you know, places like Arbo, Deir Doslebo, Gaznach, Harbul, where Assyrians have gone back and rebuilt their villages. Even if Assyrians do not return to resettle their villages permanently, it is still important for them to maintain constant and close ties both with the land and the communities still living on it, so that those people do not feel isolated and abandoned by the rest of the Assyrians outside. Here, Assyrians can obviously learn from the Armenians, who have birthright Armenia. They go and they visit Armenia, they visit Karabakh, they also have yearly pilgrimages to Armenian, abandoned Armenian monasteries and churches in eastern Turkey. And we're very happy now that for the last 6 years we have an Assyrian organization called Gishru, which has been taking Assyrians from America and from other countries to Iraq for 2 weeks every year to celebrate Chag Nisan. But we need more, and we need to support initiatives like this. It would also be a good idea for young Assyrians to get active in organizations that already make a difference to sending aid and building infrastructure in the homeland, such as the Assyrian Aid Society, which helps support many of our schools in northern Iraq. And you're going to see later on why education is so important. The most pressing issue, however, when it comes to language and cultural preservation, remains the Assyrians in the diaspora. Assyrians in the Middle East are naturally kept segregated because they, primarily, have a different religion to the majority of their neighbors, with the exception of maybe Lebanon. This aids in language preservation and slows down the process of assimilation into other cultures. Not to mention the fact that the establishment of schools in the Middle East is easier due to shorter distances traveled, larger concentrations of population, existence of a greater number of people knowledgeable or qualified enough to teach, and especially because of lower costs of building and maintenance. I should also stress that Assyrians living in their own villages or their own areas in cities are less likely to assimilate and more likely to preserve their language and culture. A case in point here would be the Amish in America, who have their own communities and still speak their own language. The Armenians in the Middle East, who have their own areas or ghettos in Middle Eastern cities. And the Jews in Middle Eastern Europe, who are able to maintain themselves that way. In many diaspora countries, however, this will not work. It will not help to put yourself in a ghetto. In lieu of that, the only solution is to set up a proper system of schools which teach Assyrian, complemented by the increase of media outlets where the language can be continuously used. So for example, books, newspapers, websites, smartphone applications, and no, this is not a real one, it's just a picture. I wish it was real. Etc. Media will also serve to keep the scattered Assyrian communities connected and informed about one another. It often surprises me how little Assyrians know about other Assyrians in other countries or from other churches or from other districts or villages. I remember being in Iran and people telling me, "Are there Assyrians in Turkey?" And when I was in Syria, people were asking me, "Are there Assyrians in Iran?" They don't know. And they don't live that far from each other. You know, you could jump in a car and go from Syria to Urmi, but they don't have any clue about what's going on. Genealogy should also be mentioned here as being important. Many younger Assyrians don't know anything beyond their own grandparents, losing much of their links with their extended families overseas, as well as their family history and tangible links to the homeland. Many don't even really know where their families originated from and what significance these places have to Assyrian history and to their own family history. Often these people hide behind the guise of ignorant nationalism. No, if you don't know where you're from, where are you going to go visit when you go to the homeland to see where your ancestors lived? Where are you going to go and get that connection that you're looking for when you go to the homeland? Anyways, this lack of knowing about themselves only perpetuates the lack of pride in their heritage and lack of confidence in their identity. Education as a solution. Now, a small case study here, the Assyrians of Urmi. The first modern Assyrian schools were established in Urmi in the mid-1830s by foreign missionaries. Prior to that, only males with church ranks were able to read or write, with the exception of maybe one or two women. So maybe 5% of the population, maybe less. About 70 years later, in 1908, roughly 80% of both Assyrian men and women in Urmi were literate. And that's a literacy rate which I think beats many countries today. And they were actually the most literate population in the Persian Empire. Assyrians had been printing literature since 1840, and in 1849 they established Iran's first newspaper, Zahrir al-Bara. So the first newspaper printed in all of Iran wasn't in Persian, it was in Assyrian. On the eve of World War I, the Urmi region boasted more doctors because Urmi had Iran's first medical college. So the area boasted more doctors, most of them Assyrian, than all of Iran put together. And Urmi, the Assyrians of Urmi, had even begun to export doctors to other provinces of the country. They were highly educated, modernizing, empowered, and confident in their future. The Urmi region was later followed in the 1840s by education systems run by the Chaldean Catholic Church and the Syrian Orthodox and Catholic churches. These churches, or the schools belonging to these churches, later produced Assyrian thinkers and national leaders, such as Professor Ashur Yusuf, who I've already mentioned, Naum Faiq, Sanharib Bali, David Barsoom Perley, Yusuf Malik, and others. According to Horatio Southgate, who visited northern Mesopotamia in the 1840s, the story of how the Syrian Orthodox schools were established is as follows. And no, that's not Horatio Southgate. That's the Armenian patriarch in Istanbul, in Constantinople. So Horatio Southgate says, when the patriarch, the Syrian Orthodox patriarch, was in Istanbul in 1838, the Armenian patriarch expostulated him on the state of the nation, and among other things said to him that a people without schools must inevitably decline. A people without schools must inevitably decline. Yani, o amma litle madrashiyate halbat ikhabniha betalak. The remark sunk deep into the mind of this patriarch and was never forgotten. On his journey home, he visited most of the places where Syrians are to be found, and in every place he established a school. Now, by 1899, Syrian Orthodox immigrants to New Jersey established the Assyrian National School Association, later called the Assyrian Orphanage and School Association of America. This organization initially funded, ran, and owned a school for Assyrian orphans in the Turkish city of Adana. There's a picture of the school right there. However, this was transferred to Beirut in 1823. Today, the association sends aid to its own schools in Lebanon. So this is a picture of their school in Beirut, as well as schools, orphanages, and monasteries owned and run by the Syrian Orthodox Church in Iraq, Lebanon, Syria, Turkey, and Israel-Palestine. It also provides scholarships for needy youth and other community services. Whilst it has been operational in the United States and is still functioning 114 years later, it only serves Assyrians from the Syrian Orthodox Church. It doesn't serve Assyrians from other churches. Now, I'm almost done. I'm just going to turn to two case studies before I get to my conclusion. Now, I'll turn to these case studies as examples from two highly successful diaspora nations, the Armenians and the Jews, especially, in an effort to show how it is not necessary to have a nation state in order to create institutions like this outside of the homeland. So firstly, Armenian education. Armenian education began in the early 19th century, initially under the direction of lay committees. These community projects not only included schools, but also hospitals and other institutions. The Armenians, in addition to paying taxes to their respective states, voluntarily imposed extra burdens on themselves in order to support such agencies. These educational and philanthropic agencies made the Armenians the most educated and wealthy group in the Ottoman Empire. By 1912, they possessed nearly 2,000 private schools with more than 170,000 pupils. One of the main supporters of Armenian education has been the Armenian General Benevolent Union, the AGBU. This is a non-profit organization established out of all places in Cairo, Egypt, in 1906. Its headquarters are now in New York. Its goal is to establish, or it was, to establish a union that would in every way assist the Armenian people, the future of which, as a minority in the Ottoman Empire, was endangered. Now, sounds familiar. We're also a Middle Eastern minority and we're also endangered. Between 1906 and 1912, the AGBU provided Armenian villagers in the Ottoman Empire with seeds, agricultural instruments, and established schools and orphanages, very similar to the work that the Assyrian Aid Society has been doing in northern Iraq since 1991. The AGBU also managed to render tangible help to survivors of the genocide, especially orphans. After World War I, the main goal of the AGBU was to preserve and promote Armenian language, identity, and heritage through educational, cultural, and humanitarian programs. The AGBU established educational institutions, a foundation to provide scholarships for Armenians to study in European universities, and even a student dormitory in Paris. AGBU activities aimed at national preservation became more effective through the establishment of cultural funds through which a number of educational and other establishments were built. And I'm very happy to say that recently Assyrians here in the United States have been establishing very similar funds. Today, the AGBU has chapters in 80 cities of 22 countries in the world, with 22,000 members, 120 branches, 27 cultural centers, spread worldwide in the USA, Europe, the Middle East, South America, and even Australia. The AGBU has 20 private schools just on its own. It has 20 private schools with more than 6,500 students, as well as 15 Saturday schools, and it finances more than 16 educational establishments. In Paris and New York, they have two libraries, and they award scholarship grants and loans to more than 500 students worldwide. With an annual international budget of $36 million, the AGBU preserves and promotes the Armenian identity and heritage through educational, cultural, and humanitarian programs, serving some 400,000 Armenians in 35 countries. In total, so not just the AGBU, who have 20 schools, Armenians as a whole, have 77 primary schools, 19 intermediate schools, 34 high schools, one college, and one university in 17 different countries outside of Armenia. In addition to this, Armenian communities in the United States have funded or endowed by themselves 16 chairs for Armenian studies 15 universities, as well as 3 community colleges in the United States. There are also a number of Armenian studies associations, institutes, and research centers, a genocide museum in Washington, D.C., and a library and museum in Boston, which is that one at the bottom there. So, Jewish education. The first Jewish day school was established in New York in 1731. Later on in the 19th century, this also developed in Germany, largely in response to the higher emphasis in general education. Later on, the Alliance Israélite Universelle, the AIU, became a driving force in the establishment of new Jewish schools. This is a Paris-based international organization founded in 1860. So do we notice something here? Assyrians like to say, we don't have a country, so we can't do anything. The AGBU was established in Cairo in 1906. There was no Armenia. The Alliance was established in Paris in 1860. There was no Israel. So basically, this Alliance was established to safeguard the rights or the human rights of Jews around the world. The organization promotes the ideals of Jewish self-defense and self-sufficiency through education and professional development. As outlined in its prospectus, the program of the society included the emancipation of the Jews from oppressive and discriminating laws, political disabilities, and defense of them in those countries where they were subjected to persecution. Sounds similar. We're also being persecuted, and we have laws discriminating against us. Now, the motto of this organization is, all Jews bear responsibility for one another. No one else is going to bear responsibility for them, and why should they bear responsibility for anyone else? They should just bear responsibility for themselves and look after themselves. From its establishment, the Alliance embarked on a civilizing mission to advance the Jews of the Middle East through French education and culture. For the attainment of its objectives, the Society proposed to carry on a campaign of education through the press as well. It opened its first school, out of all places, in the Moroccan city of Tetouan in 1862. 40 years later, the Alliance was operating 100 schools all the way from Morocco to Iran, or maybe even Afghanistan, with a combined student population of more than 26,000. They provided Jewish children from poor families with formal elementary school and vocational training. And the Alliance continues to operate dozens of schools and educational programs in Israel today. Apart from the work done by them, just here in the US, there are more than 800 Jewish day schools with an enrollment of about 230,000 children from age 4 to grade 12. There are also hundreds of thousands of Jewish children in the US who attend religious, Hebrew, and congregational schools, and there are 4 Jewish universities here in the United States, with Jewish studies being taught at 19 universities throughout the country, at least. Apart from the Armenians and Jews, other examples abound, not least the Coptic community, which not only has private schools in Australia, but also funds a Coptic Studies Center at Macquarie University, which is one of the biggest universities in Sydney. And it also runs theological colleges or seminaries linked to the main universities in Sydney and in Melbourne. Now, just on the idea of student dormitories. This is a student dormitory which I stayed in for 3 months when I was doing an exchange semester in Canada, in Toronto. It's the St. Vladimir Institute, built by the Ukrainian community in the middle of downtown Toronto, opposite the university. It not only houses students, it has a bistro which serves Ukrainian food, it is a Ukrainian cultural center, it has a theater, it has a library, and it has an archive, and it is basically a one-stop shop for anything Ukrainian in the middle of downtown Toronto. Similarly, the Jewish community in Sydney also has these student houses or student dormitories at the main universities in Sydney. So you've got Mandelbaum House, Hillel House, the Shalom Institute at the University of Sydney, the University of New South Wales, and Macquarie University. It is obvious that the only way to preserve our language and culture in the diaspora is through the establishment of private day schools with a shared and standardized educational curriculum and studies centers, with a standard educational system and curriculum, linking them with one another. It would also be beneficial to establish Assyrian studies centers, institutes, libraries, and especially chairs at major universities wherever there are large Assyrian communities. Well, large, historical, wealthy. Such accomplishments would only nurture pride and confidence, but would also foster the greater dissemination of knowledge regarding the Assyrian culture, history, and language, not only to Assyrians, but also to non-Assyrians, to both present and future generations. The Assyrians are a Middle Eastern people. Their past has been in the Middle East, and unless they establish a small state or autonomous region elsewhere, or by an island somewhere, their future should also be in the Middle East. Without maintaining links to the Middle East, to the homeland, and maintaining communities and cultural monuments there, and nourishing their cultural and linguistic development, such as what agencies like the Assyrian Aid Society have been doing, we are finished as a people. We also need to strengthen our educational and linguistic and intellectual institutions in the diaspora through the establishment of more schools, libraries, research centers, and chairs at universities. Consider the homeland as a cup full of water. Immigration from the homeland to the diaspora would be like pouring water from this cup into another one. Now, if that second cup has a hole in it, the water will eventually run out of it and be emptied. This is our situation right now. And if we don't try to close that gap through greater education, we'll get nowhere. I started this talk with the saying, know yourself. If we do not start to learn about ourselves and become more confident and proud of our language and heritage, we will eventually cease to exist. Assyrians, both in the homeland and in the diaspora, especially in the diaspora, should aim at integrating themselves into the societies in which they live, but also creating institutions which would safeguard and preserve their language, culture, and heritage, and maintaining links with the homeland. Part of this would require adopting an open mind and creating an Assyrian national narrative and identity that is truly all-inclusive and respectful of the diverse dialects, traditions, sects, food, religions, costumes, and regions that are part of the Assyrian homeland. They are us, and to know them is to know ourselves. To be truly patriotic or nationalistic, it should be the duty of every Assyrian to learn a dialect that is not their own, or to mix with Assyrians from other sects or from other religions, or to visit Assyrian communities in countries where their own families do not originate from. Many people have asked me why I did my thesis on the Assyrians of Iran. They tell me, your family's from Iraq, what business do you have in Iran? I said, well, they're Assyrians. I'm Assyrian, they're Assyrian, what is the difference? Assyrians should also be active in recording their family trees and histories, and actually acknowledging which villages and districts in the homeland they originate from, and documenting. Moreover, diaspora Assyrians should not wait for unity. That can come afterwards. By keeping ourselves busy with the never-ending and emotion-charged topics of church politics and the name issue, Assyrians will only waste precious time, which they can be using instead to get solid educations, establish themselves financially, and contribute to infrastructure building and educational projects, both in the homeland and in their own communities in the diaspora. Thank you very much.
I've been teasing.